Chapter 1, Intro. Hey everyone. So, after my last video, DIY smart LED setup with Zigbee and Home Assistant step-by-step guide, I got a bunch of questions and honestly, I realized I also left out some important details. That's why I'm back today with a quick follow-up. This one's going to be short, but really useful, especially if you've already seen the first video. Chapter 2, LED Control HQ. Let's talk about why I originally thought putting a smart switch between the mains and the power adapter was such a good idea. To show you what I mean, I'm using my Zigbee smart plug with power monitoring, and I've updated my dashboard so it's easier to follow along. On the dashboard, you can see voltage, current, and power. For this demo, I've put together two different configurations to compare how they work. Setup 1. No smart switch module. Power adapter goes straight into the mains. Adapter and LED controller are powered 24/7. The LED controller turns the lights on and off. It also manages all the LED settings. When the smart plug is off, current is obviously 0 ampere and power is 0 watt. After turning the smart plug on, the values change. Current is around 40 milliamperes and power is about 4 watts. When I switch the LED controller on, current jumps to around 70 milliamperes and power sits at 9 watts. Setup 2. The smart switch module is connected to the mains. The power adapter plugs into the smart switch. The adapter and LED controller only get power when the LEDs are on. The smart switch turns the lights on and off. The LED controller still handles all the LED settings. Same thing here, with the smart plug off, both current and power sit at 0, which is obvious. Even when I switch the smart plug on, nothing changes, still 0. It's only after I flip on the smart switch that the numbers finally move. Current jumps to about 70 milliamperes and power climbs to around 9 watts. As you can see, both configurations work, but the second one saves a little energy. When the LEDs are on, the current and power are basically the same in both cases. Technically, setup 2 should draw a little more since there's one extra device to power, the smart switch module. But the difference is so small that my smart plug doesn't even notice it. With the LEDs off, the difference is clear. In setup 1, with the power adapter connected directly to the mains, current sits at about 40 milliamperes, and power at 4 watts. In setup 2, with the smart switch in place, both current and power are so low that the smart plug just shows 0. So, what do you think? Was installing a smart switch before the power adapter a good idea? Drop a comment and tell me how you power your LEDs. Chapter 3, Dashboard. In my setup, it is the smart switch module that's actually in charge of turning the LEDs on and off, not the LED controller. That means the controller itself should always stay on, and ideally, you don't want anyone to be able to switch it off by mistake. In my last video, I showed you how I set the power on behavior of the LED controller to on, and that's exactly how it should be. I also set the hold and double tap actions to nothing, but I left the tap action as default, and that turned out to be a problem. Why? Because with the default tap action, you can still turn the LED controller off. And if the controller is off, then even if someone flips the smart switch on, nothing happens. Super confusing. The fix is simple. Just set the tap action of the LED controller to nothing as well. That way, you can still adjust all the LED settings. Colors, brightness, and temperature, but you won't accidentally shut the controller down. Chapter 4, LED Sync. Now let's talk about syncing multiple LEDs. I've experimented with a few different methods, and honestly, I realized that too many controls on the dashboard just make things messy. Instead, I went with a minimal setup, one LED control per room. This control stays hidden most of the time, and only appears if at least one LED light in that room is on. When visible, it controls all the LEDs in that room. If any of the lights are off, they'll automatically sync once turned back on. It is simple, it is clean, and it works. Sometimes less really is more. I'll show you exactly how this looks at the end of the chapter, but first, let's walk through the setup. We'll need a helper to group LEDs. In Home Assistant, open the Helpers menu and create a new helper. Choose Group, then select Light Group. Give it a clear name. And if you'd like some naming ideas, check out my video, The Perfect Naming Conventions. Simplify your smart home. Add all the LED controllers you want grouped together. For example, all the ones in your living room. Leave Hide Members disabled. Leave all entities disabled as well. That way, the group state will show as on if any member is on. Once the group is created, open Settings from the Overflow menu, the three dots on the right. Here you can set an icon, assign an area, and add labels. If you want, you can also assign a category by opening the menu again and selecting Assign Category. In my setup, which uses a smart switch, another helper is required to use as a condition in the Visibility tab. Repeat the same process, but this time, instead of a light group, select Switch Group. And add all the switches responsible for turning your LEDs on and off in the light group you just created. Now let's place the LED helper on the dashboard. I'm using a mushroom light card with the group helper as the entity. If you'd like to install mushroom cards yourself, I've got a dedicated video on my channel. Mushroom Template Card, the not-so-complete guide to Home Assistant dashboards. I used the Switch Group helper in the Visibility tab, so the control only shows up when the group is on, meaning when at least one LED is turned on. To demonstrate how this works, I added all LED switches and controllers to my dashboard. On my phone screen, you'll see the individual controls for all three strips, plus the group helper, while my camera shows two of them in real life. Here's how it works in practice. First, all three LED strips are on. I grab the group control, change the color, all of them instantly switch to the same color. Next, I turn one strip off and change the color again through the group helper. As expected, only the two that are powered respond. Then I switch the third strip back on, and after a few seconds, it syncs automatically, taking on the same settings as the others. And that's the point. You don't really need separate controls for every LED when the group helper does the heavy lifting. I'd keep individual switches just for turning strips on or off, and let the group control manage colors and other settings. And if you ever want one particular LED to have different settings, just add a separate control for it. Chapter 5. Thank you. That's it for today's update. Thanks so much for watching this follow-up. I really hope this video helped clear things up and gave you a better idea of how to improve your own smart LED setup. If you found it useful, the best way to support the channel is super simple. Hit that like button, drop a comment, and of course, subscribe if you haven't already. It really helps more people discover these videos and keeps me motivated to make more. If you'd like to go one step further, you can support the channel directly through Buy Me a Coffee or PayPal. Links are in the description. Every bit of support goes straight back into creating better tutorials, testing more devices, and sharing more smart home ideas with you. Thanks again for watching and for being part of this community. I'll see you in the next video. Until then, stay smart, stay connected, and enjoy your lighting.